Recorded Books presents The Opium Prince by Jasmine Aimaq, narrated by Pete Bradbury. Prologue. The girl lies crumpled and still in the road, like a thing thrown away. It cannot be that I am the one who has done this to her. Just a moment ago, she ran across the road, lively, smiling, and quick. Beside me, my wife is screaming. I cannot move, but I do. My hands heavy as I take them from the steering wheel and step into the desolate road. My legs protest, but I walk. I fall to my knees and take the girl's hand. A small whimper. She is alive. Please, don't move. You're going to be all right. My voice breaks, sounding alien, each word between a quiver and a sob. The girl's limbs are tangled, her head tilted at an impossible angle. A bruise blackens her neck. Her red dress grows darker, blood blooming through the cotton, which rises in the breeze and settles back onto her body, a shroud. The endless desert, the Afghan sun, the silent sky. They watch. The road is the only thing in motion. The asphalt ripples in the heat, as if ready to open up and engulf us, making the sands of Kabul province our tomb. I stroke her hair as her pain threads its way into me, into places I didn't know existed. I let out a sob, but it sounds far away. As she tries to sit up, blood spills from her brow, streaming down her face and throat. Her bare feet are wrapped in a film of dust and sand. I try to steady myself, but my hand slips in something greasy and slick, a rainbow of engine oil and blood. The asphalt buckles again. Where are your people? I say. Tell me, I'll find help. I squeeze her fingers gently, afraid to break another thing. Her lips barely move when she asks, Am I dying? No, you're going to be all right. I lie. She starts to speak. Don't talk anymore, I beg, fearing the words will end her, take the last energy that could keep her alive. Where are her parents? Sewn on her dress are little round mirrors, and I see 100 fractured close-ups of my face. She struggles again to raise her head and say something. I cradled her in my slippery hand. In the car, the music plays on. Beethoven's chords shred the air into shards. Rebecca is crying, fumbling at the buttons and dials in vain, plucking at the cassette that won't stop. With shocking force, the girl grasps my arm and hisses, I'm only 10, maybe 9. It's not fair. She tries to point to something. My doll, she says. Her eyes close. No. Stay awake, please, please, try. I'll find help. I say these words, but I understand for the first time what it means to be helpless. I hear what will be her last breath, air drawn in sharply as she dies. I watch her face for a single sign, wondering if maybe I believe in miracles after all. I swear to a God I don't believe in that I will be faithful if he shows his power now, just this once. I will never ask for anything else. I wish I could say that I didn't see her at all, that she whipped into view from nowhere, an apparition out of the desert. But it isn't true. I saw her, but only as a blur of color trailed by a playful tangle of long, dark hair. The music stops at last. Then Rebecca is there, bending over the sun-baked road. She has something in her hand. A yellow-haired doll with a mirror-dotted dress. Sweat and tears trickle from my face, salting my lips. I gather the child in my arms and hold her close, rocking her back and forth. Her form is so small, bones hollow like a bird's. Still, her weight nearly breaks me. I must find her people. I rise, afraid I might drop her. Rebecca insists she will go with me. Her tears flecking the girl's feet, and I'm a mere echo when I respond, No. Please wait in the car and lock the doors. I have never been so alone. The gates in my mind clicking shut. Walls closing in until everything is crushed but my unbreakable guilt. I look up. No clouds. No birds. No God. Only sun hitting the desert like acid rain. I walk in the middle of the road, counting my steps, turning the rhythm into a two-note lullaby. 1, 2, 3, 4. In 108 steps, I reach the steep incline in the road. I climb, knowing what I will find on the other side. At the top of the hill, the desert stretches below me. There they are. I see hundreds, maybe thousands, of Kochi nomads in reds, greens, blues, and every tone of beige and gray. This is what infinity looks like. An undulating mass of men, women, children, animals, and tents against a wall of sky. I see rifles slung across men's backs, the glint of steely blades at their hips. Fearless was how my father described them. Fearless and proud. I have few memories of my mother Dorothy, but one stabs into me now. I used to run to greet the nomad caravans when they came into town because I wanted to play with the children. My father told me they lived off the land and fought for what was theirs, that even their youngest were brave as lions, and I longed for adventures with 6-year-old nomads in the desert. My American mother would stop me, my hand in her iron grip until my fingers hurt as she told me about their 1,000-year-old laws, by which even unintentional sins could be capital crimes. I try to forget her words as I start down the sloping highway. I cross the line where asphalt gives way to sand. It takes me 18 steps to be noticed and 30 to reach the first goatskin tents. It must have taken the girl less than 4 running steps from the side of the road to the middle of it. I try to banish the image of that blur, but a child's voice whispers, "Look at me," from the deepest recesses of my mind. Kochis of every age assemble to take in the curious sight of us. For years they will talk about the stranger who walked among them wearing city clothes and carrying a dead girl. I meet the gaze of an old man, his face a study in shadow, strands of gray escaping from his turban. "Telaya," the man says, pointing to the girl. Then he asks, "What happened?" I cannot say, "I found her like this, someone must have hit her." There is no phantom killer, there is only me. I tell him she was running so fast that I didn't have time to stop. He watches me in silence. The crowd hovers, a ring of strangers coiling and uncoiling like a cobra. Staring at the corpse, people ask questions I don't answer. Others are quiet. I want them all to disappear. The accident and the girl's death are a private disaster between her and me, made profane by prying eyes and whispered speech. "Go that way," says the old man. He points to more tents, more sheep, and more people in bold colors lit brighter by the implacable sun. As I walk, people abandon their tasks to join the silent congregation forming behind me. I pass 2 men brushing strips of shorn wool. Sitting cross-legged on a rug speckled with sand, girls who would be children in America but are women here sew tea leaves into pouches. As I pass, the sounds of life and work stop, and I feel as if the silence will make me deaf or blind or mute. Destroy one of my senses to match the loss of some other indescribable thing the moment the girl died. A few feet away, several tents are wide open. They are brimming with artifacts, jewels, carpets, and mirror-dotted clothes. These are the things the nomads will sell as they trek from village to village on their way to Kabul, Ghazni, Jalalabad. But today I am the wanderer, and the nomads are the ones who are still. A woman sitting on the sand points a bony finger, not looking up from her lap. 2 women polishing copper plates notice as I make my way toward them. One of them begins to rise, then sees what is in my arms, and falls back to her knees with a stifled cry. Leaning against a younger woman, Telaya's mother sobs, terror and sorrow melding together on her face. I'm not a parent, though only a few months ago I thought I would be. When I see her fear, I think I know. I want to embrace her. I hear myself utter worthless apologies, dwarfed by the enormity of her pain and of what I have done. Basir, Telaya's mother cries out. I turn around. The girl's father is only a few feet behind me, staring. His hands start to shake. His eyes widen. Telaya? He takes her in his arms, and all I had planned to say is replaced by all I do not. I'm a fraud, the quixotic wizard behind the curtain who can't make anything right. I hear Basir's fractured breath, a whispered word to his dead child. On his face, I see that same fear. Telaya's mother is crying freely now. Then the crowd ebbs, parting for three tall men with silver beards. Word has spread to the elders who have left their work, their tea, their wives, and come here to deliberate my crime. I meet their gaze as they approach, hoping Rebecca is still inside the car and will drive off without me if she must. I hear one of the elders say, "Go find Taj." There is some commotion as young boys spin this way and that, nodding and shouting, "Where's Taj Maleki? Get Taj!" A man with thick sideburns cuts through the now silent crowd. He reaches me and stops. One finger gleams with gold, an onyx adorns the front of his turban, and his Piran Tomban tunic and trousers are finer than the other men's, made of silk. A revolver sits in his holster, a Colt with a delicate pattern engraved on its grip. I stand before this strange man whose eyes are bereft of light, as if even the sun conceded defeat long ago. "Who are you?" Taj asks in Farsi. I'm relieved I speak the language, and that no one here could guess that I spoke more English than Farsi as a child. "Daniel Abdullah Sajadi." The man takes a step forward, but his face betrays nothing. The Kochis will not recognize the name Sajadi like people in the city do. Maybe this man knows who I am, maybe not. He watches me silently. "Did you not see her?" His voice is as flat as his gaze. "She ran straight into the road. And now she is dead." "I'm sorry." Taj nods. "Who do you work for?" he says. From his dialect, I hear that he isn't a Kochi. He's from the city. "The American government." 1,000 eyes are on me. The only two people not looking at me are Telaya's parents, who are standing behind Taj. It seems indecent to watch a mother and father in their grief. I stare instead at the horizon. An outsider wouldn't know that this arid land is a great fraud of nature. Just behind these deserts are acres of vibrant opium poppies with emerald green leaves thriving under the sun. The great Yasaman field, with its rich bounty of flowers, is not far. Nature has surrounded these fields with the most fallow land on earth, giving the poppies better camouflage than it has given me. It is these flowers that I have dreamed of killing since I was a boy. Not the children who help harvest them, the descendants of those who followed my father into war against the British Empire. These thoughts speed through my head, but her voice slices through all of them. "Look at me," says the dead girl. The desert has flung me at the feet of its dwellers. I am that most vulnerable of creatures, a man out of context. I can almost smell the poppies on the wind. They seem so trivial now, when just hours ago they weighed more than anything else in my life. I fought for months at the office to convince my colleagues to begin the reform with Fever Valley's largest field. Taj looks at Telaya's corpse. Paper-white bone protrudes from her arm. Something glimmers in the sun. A shard of glass lodged above her eyebrow, nearly invisible in the curve of her hair. I feel a throbbing pain above my own eye. Basir sobs, his words tumbling over each other in despair. "God, why have you done this to us? I have no other daughters.
His wife squeezes his hand. He killed her, Basir says to Taj, pointing at me as if sentencing me to join his daughter in death. Between cries, he whispers,
She was the only thing of value in my life.
The crowd is still silent, watching them. Taj places a hand on Basir's shoulder and says, What a terrible day for you. His words are compassionate, but I wonder if the others can tell that the man is not. He's probably one of the callous merchants from the city who tricks nomads into parting with their wares for less than they're worth, who travel with them for days at a time, choosing the best rugs and jewels, and bartering them for a little food, money, perhaps medicine. Kochis are sophisticated tradesmen, too sharp to fall for such tricks, and yet there are exceptions. Some earn enough to become members of the country's sliver of a middle class, but Taj Maleki must be one of the tricksters taking advantage of those who do not, with his expensive clothes and his cheap sympathy. He goes on. Your loss is a great one. She can never be replaced. He assures the parents that they must not worry. There will be restitution. The word is an escalating sequence of four notes, the final syllable a battle cry. When he moves, his gun gleams in a familiar way I cannot place. The Colt is an ordinary weapon. My father taught me to fire one when I was six. But there is something else about it that is familiar. The memory is there, but I cannot connect past and present. The girl's mother trembles, her face contorted as she spears me with her gaze. I take a step back, walking into the person behind me. I turn around and tell the young man I'm sorry. He stares at me, unmoving. All around me, I see menace painted on men's faces. Their knives and guns fill my vision. I fight back the stories I grew up with. Where were you traveling to? Taj says. Herat. From Kabul? Yes. Of course. I'm so sorry. A voice inside me says I shouldn't have come into the desert among these men. I know I don't want to die here. But there is another kind of knowing, one that rests deep in my bones like fossils in shale. My father used to tell me, the rich world has rules and regulations. The poor world has rituals and traditions. These worlds weigh the same. Taj raises his hand and stops me before returning to the elders. They whisper things I am not meant to hear, shaking their heads as they speak, gesturing in turn to the road and the desert and the tents. Yes, one of the elders says loudly. That's fine. Taj shakes his hand and stalks toward me, grasping my arm without stopping. He jerks his chin toward the road. We're going to the police. I'm ashamed at my relief. I want to get away from here, even if this man is the only way out. As we pass the girl's parents, Taj gestures toward the road and they fall in step with us. Basir is still holding the corpse, but I feel the child's weight as if she is back in my arms. I know that she will always be in my arms. The trek back to the car feels shorter than the walk into the desert. Soon we will be at the police station where I will again have to confess. They will know who I am. It may save me. But Taj is watching me like the wind watches the leaves, knowing it may toss them as it likes, loosen them from trees at will. Rebecca's arms are wrapped around her, her hair whipping in the breeze, face pale and eyes swollen. Today is our anniversary, but it seems small now, too. I'd hoped to see her as she used to be, to find even a trace of joy. Instead, I have added to her grief from 3 months ago. She has moved the car to the edge of the road. She sees no one but me, her clouded eyes searching my face. I can scarcely glance at her, much less meet her gaze. I'm crushed by the weight of Telaya's death and further by the weight of my wife's love, because at this moment, I don't deserve it. No words are exchanged, no introductions made. The girl's parents wedge into the back seat with Taj, Telaya slumped across their laps. I see Taj gently pry the shard of glass from her face, and I feel that stabbing pain above my eye again. Taj asks if I know the station north of here. I do. I dig my hand into the scalding leather of the steering wheel. It comforts me, one pain making another recede. The radio, now warped with indentations, is mercifully silent. On the floor are ordinary tools I usually keep in the trunk. I had to make it stop, Rebecca whispers. But I'm not staring at the tools. Under her seat is a mop of yellow wool, the tousled locks of the broken doll. The car is spangled with pastel rainbows cast by the mirrors on Telaya's dress. It must have been the finest one she owned. The mirrors on the dolls are making rainbows too, smaller ones that dance across Rebecca's ankles. I turn the key and the engine comes alive. High above us, a bird of prey soars into view, shuddering against the burning blue dome. Chapter 1. On that scalding August day, Sergeant Najib sat behind his desk polishing the barrel of his gun. He liked being a sergeant, despite the fool of a constable they had given him and the discomfort of his starchy uniform in the heat. Outside, there was nothing but a two-lane highway and the beige, boundless desert dotted with the occasional grungy bush or approaching mass of a nomad migration. Najib was proud to be the king of this solitary mud box perched on the Kabul-Kandahar highway. From his station, he proudly served the young republic, proving that it was a serious entity. So serious that there were outposts of law and order even in places where the only real laws were those of nature, and the only real orders those of a warlord. Najib had loyally served the king, too, before the coup that had sent him packing 4 years ago. Slipping the gun into his holster as noisily as he could, Najib stroked the cover of his well-thumbed Quran, then cast a glance at his young underling. Najib liked to think that the boy was a dedicated servant. It was an accepted fact that Kochi nomads were up to all sorts of trickery, and soon he would catch one of them in the act of something expressly forbidden, like passing off tin as silver, or riding mules loaded with the remains of harvested poppies in the hopes of starting their own field. The grumble of a car interrupted his daydreams about glorious arrests and impending promotions. The constable shuffled out of his seat, turning to him for a cue. Najib might have walked to the station's only window, a cutout in the wall split by three vertical bars, but he would see no car from there. But Imbecile had placed the single lookout point facing the desert instead of the road. He stalked out of the station, the younger man on his heels. A sand-colored Mercedes was slowing down by the station. It dipped onto the shoulder of the road, kicking up dust before coming to a stop. Najib's eyes fell on the hazy veil of blood on the grill, the red-streaked hood, the spider-webbed windshield. Inside the car was the strangest mix of folk. A stunning yellow-haired woman caught his eye first, then an urban type at the wheel, and a cluster of Kochis in the back. It occurred to him that these might be the outlaws he'd been waiting for. He hooked his thumb into his holster and stood still. He would let them come to him. The driver stepped out. Above the man's right eye was a swollen, bloody gash. His shirt was stained, too. The blonde woman emerged, moving with a determination that reminded Najib of one of his wives. The last time this many people had turned up at once was when some hoodlums had organized a pack beast race and a luckless camel had tried to outrun a big rig instead of the other animals. An unanticipated yet exciting twist that ended with the parched beast collapsing in a heap on the highway, making the asphalt look like it had grown a hump and the terrified driver swerving off the road, his 18-wheeler belly up like a giant bug. Luckily, there had been no deaths, except the woman who had worn a chadari, a blue burqa, whose name no one knew and whose age no one could guess because they made sure she remained covered as she died. Daniel had passed the solitary police outpost before, paying it little mind as he drove toward the fields of Fever Valley. As he stepped out of his car, the breeze rising from the desert was like a whisper from the poppies to the north. The policeman studied him with narrowed eyes, his hands behind his back. An airplane glided over them, leaving a feathery wake in the sky. The officer tilted his head and spoke.
Talam Seb, you have some business for the police?
There's been an accident. The officer nodded at the Mercedes and called him sir again.
I see, Seb. Why are there Kochis in your car?
A girl was run over. I brought her here.
Alive?
Daniel shook his head.
Are you the one who killed her?
A psychedelically painted 18-wheeler downshifted as it passed, curious heads poking out of painless windows. A dozen men sitting tailor-style on the tarp-covered cargo. It lumbered up the highway amid puffs of diesel. Daniel closed his eyes. A series of images surfaced in his mind like sepia photos in darkroom chemicals. He was driving. You never think of how it is for me, Rebecca had said. An accusation. She was wrong, he told her. She cried. Sometimes I wish we hadn't come here. He tightened his grip on the wheel. More accusations. All the while, that wretched sonata played on. He fumbled in the glove compartment looking for a tape. A stupid Neil Diamond tape, which would lighten the mood because she thought he was corny and would make her laugh. He looked away from the road only for an instant. He had wanted to make her laugh, and instead, he'd made her scream. A thin scream, not more than a single note, yet so vast it couldn't be contained by the car, slamming against the windows and breaking right through the glass. Daniel. Rebecca sounded far away, and when he opened his eyes, he found that he had wandered into the road, where he stood wrapped in the lingering vapors of the vanished truck's exhaust.
Come inside, the sergeant said.
Daniel shook his head. We can't leave the girl in the car.
The man shrugged and went inside.
Taj and Basir lifted Telaya's body out, her toes dragging against the metal doorframe. Her dress bunched up around her knees, and Taj covered them back up as if they betrayed a lack of modesty. Daniel watched through the haze of the brightly lit day, his eyes falling on the child's mangled arm. Many years ago, in the back of his father's car, Daniel saw a Kochi boy running along the edge of the desert, flashing a brilliant smile as he waved. Daniel waved back, mesmerized by the boy's bare feet, the way they kicked up no dust and seemed never to land at all. A rabid dog was running toward the boy, and Daniel tried to warn him, banging on the window and pointing. But the boy only kept on, chasing the car and laughing until the dog was upon him, and at the very last second, the boy hopped to the side and produced a blade, lodging it in the animal's neck. Daniel begged the chauffeur to stop, but his father forbade it, warning him that Kochis didn't make good playmates. Later, he asked his father if everybody's feet were made the same, and Sayed answered,
Their feet, yes. Their heads, no.
That night, Daniel dreamed of heads that floated up from bodies and small, battered heels that split open to reveal pockets of shattered glass. As he walked now, he felt that shattered glass push up through his feet and move through his body. Something in the car drew his eye. A mirror had come loose from Telaya's dress, gleaming in the empty back seat. It was small and solitary, sending the sun's rays back to the sky, as if to say, No, I have no more use for your light. Daniel picked up the mirror and put it in his pocket. He wanted something of hers to remain with him. The group filed into the station, Daniel the last to enter. Flies descended on the dead girl, nesting in her blood-matted hair, her ears, her drying wounds. Her mother waved them away, but they returned as if attached by springs. Sergeant Najib introduced himself curtly and presented his constable as Mir. The younger man twisted his mouth into a smile that suggested both surprise and apprehension. Taj was asked to surrender his gun, which he did without quarrel. The Kochis sank to the floor against a wall, Telaya across their laps, the mother smoothing the child's dress, polishing its mirrors with her tears and a finger. The sounds of her grief played awkwardly in concert with the one-note drone of the flies and the hiss of the damaged fan doing its best from a corner. Daniel felt a quiver of nausea. The station was powered by a diesel generator that gave off a noxious odor, which blended with that of the remains of fried food peeking out from wax paper in an overflowing bin. Afraid he would buckle, Daniel leaned against a wall. Beside him was a three-legged table where a chess match stood abandoned, marble pieces darkened by a veil of dust. Najib offered Rebecca the only chair besides his own. The rusty metal screeched as he dragged it to where she stood. She lowered herself carefully and mouthed a thank you. Daniel watched her, wishing he could wrap her in his arms and tell her that everything would be okay. On the wall near Mir's stool hung a calendar made for Westerners and Western-minded locals. Miss August reigned over the station with a sultry eye and an outstretched hand. Daniel recognized her as someone who had once modeled jewels made from the gemstones in his father's mines. Daniel still called those mines his father's, even though they were his now. His father had made the mines famous, raised armies of villagers and nomads throughout the country, and used his fortune to pay for weapons of war, bribes and the most modern guns in the world. Anything to help expel the English and keep the Russians at bay. Sayyid Sajadi had outshone the king's own armies with his troops of Kochis. Now one of their children had died at Daniel's hands. Najib asked for his name. When he replied, the sergeant lowered his pen. Related? Daniel nodded and the sergeant's body relaxed. With a broad smile, he insisted on shaking Daniel's hand before asking Mir to bring Coca-Colas for everyone. They're going to drink Cokes now? Rebecca held her arms out, palms open, as if the answer to her question might trickle down from the ceiling. Shouldn't we take this girl to a hospital? Najib scoffed.
For what? She's obviously dead.
So they can make a record, write down the cause of death. When Najib indicated that no such thing was needed, Rebecca breathed out slowly. Daniel could hear an emotion in her exhale, though it was unclear what kind. He would tell her later that no record could be made about people who never officially existed in the first place. In America, his friends sometimes used the phrase becoming a statistic like it was something to be avoided. They complained about the government turning them into a number. What a luxury that would have been for Telaya. To find her name on a ledger, to be a statistic. The now unctuous sergeant asked excited questions about Daniel's father and other things that had nothing to do with the accident, which he seemed to have forgotten for a moment. Then he returned to the subject, checking off boxes and filling in blanks. What is your job? My husband works for USADE, Rebecca said. He's the director here.
The United States against the drug economy?
It was not Najib who had spoken, but Taj. With a thin smile, he added, And what do you do there, exactly?
I ask the questions, Najib said.
A sheen of sweat was visible above his lip, and Daniel heard the tremor in his voice. Mir stood in a corner, jerking his head toward whoever spoke. What do you do there, exactly? Taj repeated.
We help farmers stop growing poppies and teach them how to plant other things, like food.
Does that work? Najib said.
Daniel told him four fields had already been reformed. He didn't say that only a few small-scale growers had agreed to the change, or that of the seven important fields of Fever Valley, just one would be reformed, and by force, in the hope that the great opium khans, invisible like gods, would capitulate. He didn't say that a farmer had approached his agency with a message from these poppy overlords, quietly offering money in return for being left alone. USADE had, under Daniel's direction, refused the bribe.
Then you are the director? You are young for such a post, the sergeant said. I suppose a man like you rises quickly through the ranks.
Daniel had no intention of explaining how he had come into the position he'd only held for 7 months. He'd even managed to avoid explaining it to his staff. Najib asked how fast Daniel had been driving, where he'd been heading, and where the accident happened. He sounded bored. With every answer, Daniel replayed another part of the accident in his mind, wondering what would have changed if he'd looked up just a moment sooner, or if they had left Kabul a few minutes earlier, or if he hadn't forgotten the suitcase and gone back to the house. Enough, Taj said, as if hearing his thoughts. He pointed to Basir, who was weeping softly.
Look at the state my friend is in.
I'm not sure she knew what a car was, Daniel said. Sometimes Kochi children didn't. They would watch from the side of the road, laughing, dropping whatever they held, and run dangerously toward the giant metal animals. Basir shook his head, eyeing Daniel with contempt.
She knew what a car was, Taj said.
He was the only thing in motion in the room except for the blades of the fan and Najib's fast-moving fingers. Daniel fought the nausea that twisted in his gut. It came not only from the stench of diesel and stale smoke, but from the crash and from Taj and his gun and a memory he was still struggling to conjure. Through the window bars, long afternoon shadows leaned into the room. The day was slowly cooling, but Daniel only grew warmer, as if his body absorbed each degree the dead girl lost, her corpse growing rigid and cold as he burned. He slid down the wall to the floor, looking here and there, anywhere but at her. Above him, Miss August sparkled with empty promises of magic flight. He drew the back of his hand across his brow. Only when he saw the smudge on his cuff did he realize there was a cut above his eye. The insignificance of the injury struck him as obscene. Najib tore the wrapper off a packet of Winston's, tapping the bottom and sliding out a cigarette. When Daniel had been in college, Winston had sponsored the Flintstones. On the rare days, Rebecca took a break from the piano, and before she'd sworn off substances that dulled her senses, they'd spent afternoons smoking cigarettes and weed in her apartment and giggling at the Stone Age family. She's an unregistered person, so the compensation to the parents will be low. The sergeant spoke as if the words left a bad taste in his mouth, not because he objected to Telaya being described as unregistered, but because he objected to her being described as a person. He wrote something on the form, taking his time before bringing it to Daniel with a pen. The page was sparse, a few vacant rectangles with captions in Farsi and English, and in bold print across the top, Daniel read the English version. Confession of persons making accidents by animal or auto. Underneath was the option to check off with dead or without dead. At the bottom was a space for the sergeant's comments. Najib had described the event in Farsi and closed with his version in English. With car, Daniel Sajadi killed the girl. Monies are 10,000 Afghanis. So that was it. Telia's parents would do just over $100. Daniel's gaze dissolved into the word that spelled his deed. Killed. He felt the sharpness of the K, one of its arms angling diagonally toward the sky, the other downward toward hell. K for kid, Kochi, Kabul, and Keystone Cop. Between the two L's, he saw the road. The Kochis couldn't write, so it fell to Daniel to provide details about the victim. What was Telaya's last name? Her family had none. Her age? She had said 10 or maybe 9. Her parents weren't sure either. Where do we send the money? Rebecca said, her voice quiet and hoarse. You pay before you go, Najib replied, tightening his lips as if suppressing a chuckle before adding, Kochis don't keep postal boxes, madam. She fetched her handbag from the car and gave Basir a clip of bills. There had been more than 10,000 Afghanis in the wallet, and Daniel wondered if she had offered it all, too embarrassed to count. He hoped she had. Basir studied the money like it posed a problem to which he had no solution. It occurred to Daniel that if Kochis couldn't read or write, maybe they couldn't count either. Basir passed the money to Taj, who leafed through the bills, counting out loud as he went. He nodded. Telia's parents thanked Taj for his kindness, tears trickling down their faces. Safeguarding the bills in his holster, Taj gathered Telia in his arms, leading the parents to the door. You can't bury the girl near my station, Sergeant Najib waved dismissively at the corpse. Take her back where she belongs. Daniel wished he could bury her on a gentle green hill. Instead, her time on Earth would end with terse last rites in a desert with no shade and no name, an unmarked grave no one would visit, and kin who would return incidentally, if at all.
In the world of cities, buildings, and streets, people's memories of those they loved were framed by places and times. And no place was different from any other, only deserts and fields that looked alike, and there was no measure of time other than sunup and sundown. What frame preserved the dimming faces of the dead? Nomads didn't have photos to remember them by, nor a home to return to and say, this is where she walked, this is where she played. But Daniel would always know exactly where she died, and he thought the burden of honoring her memory would fall partly on him, her killer. Outside, Mir was walking back to the station with a bucket of water in his hand. A wet rag was flung over his arm as pink droplets vanished into the earth. The blood was gone from the car. Basir and his wife climbed in the back. Taj loaded the girl onto their laps. Rebecca stood by the car, bracing herself for a second ride in a confined space with a corpse, grieving parents, and a man whose flat eyes she'd avoided all afternoon. The pills bulged awkwardly in Taj's holster, drawing Daniel's attention again to the gun. It was familiar, like a song that Daniel knew the words to, and all that mattered was its name. Do you know what happens next, Daniel Sajadi? Taj said. Daniel heard an echo in his mind, something from long ago. What do you see? It was a line from a game he used to play after his mother walked out. He would sit behind his father's desk after Sayed had gone to bed and pick an object, a jewel, a glove, or a comb. He made himself guess if it belonged to his mother or to the woman his father was married to now. With a flashlight and magnifying glass, he would examine the piece, turn it over, weigh it in his palm like he'd seen antique dealers do. Then he would render his verdict, declaring if the object was mother or other. He would make it his mission to find out without asking his father, checking instead with the housekeeper. When he was right, it was like remembering something he wasn't sure he'd ever really known, a haze of memory hardening into fact. Taj had retrieved his gun and began polishing it with a handkerchief. What do you see? And now Daniel saw. The flower carved into the colt was a poppy. The corpse and the accident in the station receded, and the flowers grew until they filled his vision. Daniel wondered why he hadn't seen it before. It was the second time today his sight had failed him. Taj Maleki was an opium khan. Chapter 2. Daniel rubbed his aching brow and opened the wound, blood dripping onto his lashes. Offering his handkerchief, Taj said, you must return to the camp with me and the parents. He could have been issuing an invitation to lunch. Then why did you bring me to the police? Daniel said, wondering what kind of trick the man was playing. He refused the handkerchief, blotting the blood with his sleeve. There's nothing more I can do. I'm not going anywhere with you. Honor requires it, Seb. You know this. Taj lowered his head and his voice. I assure you, you will not die. Daniel understood why some locals called the great opium khans manticores, after the mythical creature with the body of a lion and rows of razor-sharp teeth like a shark's. The manticore's dragon tail was filled with poison, and when it attacked a man, it left no part of him behind. Rebecca stood by the car door, which she held open, watching Daniel. In her eyes, he could see it. She wanted to leave not only the station, but the road, the desert, probably the country. They know where you work, Taj said. Daniel wondered if the Kochi tribe would send men after him to extract revenge months or even years from now. Rebecca. What if they avenged the girl by harming Rebecca? I'm not afraid of them, he told Taj. Taj smiled, revealing a hairline crack in one of his incisors, a single flaw in an even row of teeth. A man who says he is not afraid is afraid. So why not come now while I am here to protect you? From the station, an Indian chanteuse whined out a song that Daniel had heard 1,000 times. Sergeant Najib sat in a chair visible through the open door, uninterested in his lingering Kochi guests.
I hope you understand my point, Daniel Sajadi, Taj said. He ran his sleeve over the gun one last time before returning the weapon to its holster. Rebecca approached them with quick steps.
Let's go, she whispered.
Taj drifted back into the station, the end of his turban floating in the wind. Once alone, Daniel and Rebecca argued. When she learned that he planned to return to the desert, she swayed as if things holding her together were escaping. He held her by the shoulders. He didn't say that he had no choice. He only told her he would be safe. And he believed it. An opium khan wouldn't kill an American official. This wasn't Burma or Colombia with their turf wars and drug killings. There was no such violence here. The khans weren't cartels, but a scattering of powerful and mysterious men who ruled more because people needed them than because people feared them, though no one wanted to cross a manticore. Nor would Taj allow the elders to execute Daniel. But then would have been the point of bringing him to the station. All they would want was ceremonial apologies, perhaps more money. Daniel's confidence slowly returned. He would manage. He was the son of Sayed Sajadi. Rebecca's eyes were red and her breath was faint and light. She was watching Taj, who stepped back inside the station, and asked Sergeant Najib a question they couldn't hear.
We need to leave, she insisted, pulling Daniel toward the car.
Her hair had come loose from its ponytail, golden strands clinging to her brow. Daniel took her hand and promised he would return quickly, that it was just a formality, tradition.
You're crazy, she said. Don't do this.
Madam, Taj called out, I'm sure the young constable would be honored to escort you to a hotel of your choice in Ghazni. She crossed her arms tightly and lowered her head, her lips trembling. But it is the closest city, Taj said, as if her resistance were due to apprehension about geography. The rumble of an engine was followed by the appearance of Mir, who had brought a car around from behind the station. A Moskvich, the Soviet answer to Datsun. It had three hubcaps and a bent fender.
He's harmless, Daniel told Rebecca.
It was true. There had been men like Mir and Sayed's every warehouse and factory.
If you think that's the guy I'm afraid of, you've had a different day than me.
Taj held the back door of the Moskvich open, but she took the passenger seat and slammed down the lock, shutting out Taj, her husband, and the day itself. Daniel told Mir to drive to the Ariana Hotel in Ghazni, whispering the directions, aware of Taj lurking. The young constable steered Rebecca onto the highway. The drive back to the Kochi camp was aggressively silent, like the aftermath of an explosion. Daniel resisted the urge to turn over the wheel to Taj. He would have let anybody drive the car if only he could avoid passing the place where it happened. He could control the car, he told himself. More difficult were his thoughts. Those childhood memories returned. Dorothy's stories of the violence of the Kochis, the paintings that hung in his father's offices and factories, depicting nomads heading into battle with zeal. His foot was rigid on the gas pedal, hands tight on the wheel. Basir and his wife had known all along what Taj was. Of that, Daniel was sure. In a month, the great opium harvest would begin, so like the other khans, Taj was likely searching for workers in the nomads' sprawling camps. Daniel should have known the moment he'd seen the man, so out of place there with his onyx and silk. But Daniel had always assumed that manticores sent their underlings to choose workers. Maybe the khans didn't trust anyone they hadn't seen with their own eyes. Maybe they wanted fear and love from those in the fields, and these sentiments were best engendered face to face. A convoy of tanks rolled past them toward Kabul. The last one stood out, though Daniel couldn't say how. The tanks shrank in the rearview mirror where Daniel also found Basir's eyes. The old man's weathered features softened into a smile, a look of pity mixed with something inscrutable. At the Kochi camp, Taj assisted the parents with the body, declining Daniel's help. The day was ending, the sun burnishing the silver-plated sky.
Wait here, he said. For what?
Would you prefer to come and face the elders?
I don't understand.
You don't have to.
Taj said goodbye to the parents and watched them cross the road. Daniel's pulse was unsteady. The Kochi couple was soon out of sight.
What is this? Daniel said. You told me you were bringing me to stand trial with the elders.
Taj gestured to the driver's seat, but Daniel hesitated. He looked toward the Kochi camp, wondering if he could seek safety there, then realizing that he was trapped between two forces he knew little about. Somewhere deep inside, he had the answer, but all he could hear was Telaya's voice.
I'm faster than you, she whispered. Do you see me?
The Khan bowed slightly and waved his hand toward the car again. If you have something to tell me, you can call my office. Most of your colleagues have agreed to work with us, Daniel lied. The Khan laughed as if he just heard a long-anticipated punchline. My colleagues? The small farmers you work with are not my colleagues. He said small the way people in Rebecca's Los Angeles neighborhood said southern. He pointed to the car again, this time with the barrel of his gun, and it was like he had never laughed at all. Drive, he said. If you behave yourself, everyone lives.
I didn't get to live, the girl hissed. The man who took my life should die too.
Daniel tightened his grip and engaged the gears too hard, heaving the car onto the road. The Kochi camp fled behind them. The desert stretched taut like a colorless canvas. And in the side mirror, Daniel could still see that small boy from long ago, with his wild smile and flying feet and sunshine that caught his mirrored cap like a halo. He drove faster. In Fever Valley, poppies bloomed red, purple, and white, a technicolor maze inviting you to lose yourself. These were not the cheerful blossoms of California. To Daniel, these flowers signaled death. But for others, they signaled life. Since childhood, he had heard about the rhythm of the opium harvest. Every fall, the poor came to collect in the hopes of a year. Their wages were so small, they counted them in fractions. A destitute man could proudly call himself a farmer because he helped reap a field. In the spring, he would help sow seeds. His wives, his daughters, and sons, everyone came with a small blade, same as last year, working alongside the professionals. The old uncle who never found a wife, who aged alone in something that looked like a town but had no name, he came too, though he moved slower than the others. He might earn enough to buy a box of potatoes, a jug of oil, and save a little money to someday buy a goat of his own. Every summer, those who knew him asked, "Did you buy the goat?"
"Not this year," he replied. "Next year, inshallah, God willing."
Daniel grew up on those stories, told to him by his father and Sherzai, the man who had become his guardian after Sayed died and the Iranian woman Sayed was married to decamped to Tehran with her relatives. Even today, Sherzai would tell Daniel stories about a time he recalled only vaguely. The days when there was no Fever Valley, just vast fields in the northeastern corners of the country, and lesser-known plots hundreds of miles south of here in Helmand province. Tucked away in the south were hidden swaths few people could find beyond the flat deserts where only camel thorn grew. He wondered how much Taj knew about Sayed Sajadi. He spoke like someone who wanted others to think he'd had an education, but something in his inflection, the way he seemed to strain to articulate longer words instead of swallowing the middle syllable, told Daniel that the Khan had been born someone else. His name sounded impossible, too, chosen by a person who had come into the world without one. That the Sajadis were rich was no secret. Schoolchildren learned about Sayed, the war hero, but depending on the teacher's leanings, Sayed either became the Republican who bravely challenged the king, or the traitor who insulted the monarchy. He had gained followers after helping to drive out the English and eventually challenged the king's candidate for the governorship of Helmand, promising he would rid the province of the small but growing opium farms. Daniel was only 8 when the royal army arrested his father. Sherzai explained that no king could abide a man who was more popular than he was. Maybe Taj only planned to extort money, demanding cash in return for not broadcasting the accident within the better circles of Kabul. Drug lords understood money,
never content with what they had, spending their lives like magpies hoarding shiny things. Daniel wondered if they also understood the shame that decent people felt when they harmed the less fortunate. "Turn here," Darsh said after more than an hour on the desolate road. Daniel found himself on an unpaved path, surrounded by a night so black he never knew what was ahead. And yet he knew Taj was leading him to the Yasaman field. He had been here 4 times in 6 months. How different it was at night, empty of USADE's crews who came and went each day with their notebooks, shovels, and bright, shining hopes. How much more alive it seemed in this darkness with the wind and the flowers and a whispered dialogue. The car lurched along like a skiff on stormy waters. Daniel skirted a curve in the road, his headlights gliding over stunted trees, dying of thirst on the margins of a great opium field, the well-watered poppies a cruel taunt. "I know who you are," Daniel said at last.
"You know what I am. You do not know who I am."
"Why did you tell me we were going back to the elders?"
"I wanted to talk to you, man to man. I'm sorry if I frightened you."
"You didn't."
"Forgive me. It was presumptuous to think a man of your lineage should be frightened by anything a humble servant like me might come up with."
Taj signaled for Daniel to stop in a clearing and follow him into the field, gesturing again with his gun. They passed the equipment that stood along the edge, the power plows that USADE had brought to the field. A cloud slipped away from the moon, and the Danico Hastings logo was briefly visible on the machines, which looked like reconstructed dinosaurs in a museum. Daniel's crew had already begun digging channels that would bring water from the thin river nearby. Though they wouldn't be used for several more weeks, Daniel had made sure tillers and cultivators were brought to the field too, warning the Khans of what was to come, pressuring them to abandon these poppies, this life. Judging by the man beside him, Daniel had failed. They walked into the night, crossing what should have been a stream but was a dry ditch. The poppies rose up before them, a fragile truce between beauty and poison. They rustled, protesting Daniel's clumsy advance, while Taj nipped forward with ease and purpose. A small breeze lifted, scattering lost petals and leaves. Along the eastern margin of the field were boulders and shrubs Daniel had never noticed before. The rest was familiar.
"Every year I need more workers," Taj said. "The nomads are good. They're used to sleeping outside, and they'll take scraps of food as payment. They're not so different from animals."
Something violent bloomed in Daniel's mind, and it was the color of Telaya's dress. "There are animals that compare favorably to you," he said.
"I didn't once know a cat who displayed an enviable talent for strategic planning, and I'll admit to a fondness for llamas."
"Llamas?"
"They command a certain respect. It takes great insight and spirit to spit at human beings."
"They rarely spit at human beings. They spit to remind lower-ranking llamas of their place."
The Khan stopped and faced him. "Is that so?"
Not far ahead, a flicker of white danced above the poppies, the moon reflected in a window. It was the shack Daniel had entered a few months ago, hoping to find a place to leave his jacket and briefcase. He turned back around at the sight of rats gnawing at an old mattress. They were heading straight toward it now. "How long have you had this field?" Daniel said.
"I don't know. I don't like time."
"That's understandable. Time isn't working in your favor. Your days here are numbered."
"Everybody's days are numbered."
"Some of us have more favorable numbers than others. You're up against men who are smarter than you, with much more money. This will become farmland."
"It's already farmland," Taj said.
Daniel wished this pointless tour would end. He had essentially been brought at gunpoint and couldn't decide if he was supposed to behave as if the gun was there or not. Part of him thought that the Khan meant to end his life, but he was strangely unafraid. It was as if the accident had snuffed out some capacity for perspective or feeling. Some events were so immense they could drain someone of a lifetime of emotions.
Make this disappear. Taj spoke as if reiterating something they had already agreed upon. The gun was still in his hand.
Leave my field.
That's impossible.
Did I not take you away from the elders when you begged for someone to save your life?
I didn't beg, and it's not the same thing.
Indeed it isn't. Some would say the favor I'm asking for is small in comparison.
Daniel began to wonder if his faith in the region's safety was misplaced. He thought again about the war on drugs in other countries. USADE had lasted just 4 weeks in Burma, its director gunned down on an open road. The violence had to start at some point, before which people said, "Those things don't happen here." Daniel turned and walked toward the car.
"Not yet," the Khan said. "Give me an answer."
Daniel kept walking. "I'm only one man."
"You're a Sajadi and the director of your agency. They'll do what you say."
"You don't know what you're talking about. It's my government, not me, that's taking a field."
"Men like us don't have governments."
"Men like us?"
"Whenever a man has a government, then the government has the man. If you are wise, which of course you are, you will aim your loyalties elsewhere."
Taj pointed to the shapes at the eastern edge of the field.
"Look closely," he said. "Do you see?"
Daniel's eyes fell on the bumpy bundles beside the machines. They looked like large, grotesque weeds sprung from the earth without order or design. He walked toward them. One of them stirred. They were not weeds. They were human beings. Dozens, maybe more, with threadbare clothes and provisions bundled into sacks. A pageantry of want.
"Without an opium harvest, they would be paid nothing," Taj said.
"Don't you care?"
"Your fake concern isn't any more convincing now than it was
when you killed the girl."
Daniel didn't reply. He looked at the poppy pickers. Seth and Iggy, USADE's best engineers, came to Yasaman 2 days a week, sometimes more, and had told him that the channels were coming along, the crews working diligently. But there were other crews too, the poppy workers, mainly villagers and Kochis, whom Daniel saw each time he came to observe. They worked from sunrise to sunset, serving the Khans, whom no one ever saw. This year, the poppy workers kept to one edge of the field to avoid the machines and crews on the opposite side.
"Leave our land alone," Taj said. "It isn't yours. It belongs to the poppies and those who pick them."
"The people who want you out have more resources than you could dream of."
"You have no idea what I dream of, and I have a resource they cannot match."
"What would that be?"
"Hunger," Taj said. "It is the greatest resource of all, because it is infinite.
It won't exist anymore once we're done here."
"Americans watch too many movies. You think people in poor places dream of fields of rice and wheat, but the poorest people don't dream about the means to an end. They dream about the end itself, enough money to live and something extra to give to their children. Your crops will never out-earn the poppies."
On the gentle wind, the flowers whispered in agreement. Or maybe they were mocking the nearby land, visible from Yasaman. The Gulzar field was a naked, barren lot where a handful of poppies struggled to grow. Fever Valley sometimes reminded Daniel of New York, where Tiffany neighborhoods were divided from ghettos by mere blocks. They stood at the threshold of the shack, its metal door ajar. The smell of old tea, sweat, and tobacco drifted into the night, but there was another.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.